First on CBS This Morning, Michael Jackson's family, they are speaking out about sexual abuse allegations against the singer in an explosive new HBO documentary. In Leaving Neverland, Wade Robson and James Safechuck claim Jackson abused them for years when they were young children. The documentary premieres this weekend. Jackson has always denied any inappropriate behavior with children. Safechuck and Robson both sued the Jackson estate, but their lawsuits were dismissed because of the statute of limitations. They are now appealing that. The Jackson family insists those claims are lies. We spoke to Michael Jackson's nephew, Taj, and brothers Jackie, Marlon, and Tito. I take this interview very, very seriously because it is very disturbing to me. And that's why I did want to talk to this child psychologist who's an expert. And she said it is extremely rare for teenage boys to make false claims of inappropriate sexual conduct against a man in particular.
Unless you're Michael Jackson.
Wade Robson met Michael Jackson when he was five. James Safechuck filmed a commercial with Jackson just before he turned nine. Both say that for years, the pop icon invited them to his homes and molested them. Accusations the Jackson family vehemently denies.
One thing that struck me that Wade said, he calls Michael Jackson one of the most kindest, gentle, loving, caring people, person he knows, who helped him creatively, but also sexually abused him from the ages of 7 to 14. Do any of you think that both can be true?
Michael helped him in what he wanted to do and with videos and music from that side of things. But if Neverland was so horrifying for him, and why would you keep going back?
None of us in this room were there at the time that these allegations were made. So how can you say what they're saying are lies?
No, we weren't there, and nobody was there, but the facts are a public record. I mean, would he testify under oath, all the different things that he said? Those are the facts.
In the past, both men have said that Jackson never harmed them. In 1993, Safechuck gave a statement to police for a molestation case involving another boy. No criminal charges were filed. In 2005, when Jackson faced criminal charges, Robson took the stand. His testimony is often credited with helping Jackson win in court.
Wade and James both say, Wade in particular has admitted, yes, I lied on the stand. Yes, I lied under oath. Yes, I lied to my parents. Yes, I lied to everyone I cared about because I wanted to protect Michael. He did not want to be the one, in his words, that harmed Michael Jackson. Do you not believe him when he says that?
I do not believe him when he says that because we know our brother. Michael wouldn't do anything like that. And then he waits until after the passing of Michael, 10 years later, to come out and state this. And they're still in court with their estate, suing them for hundreds of millions of dollars.
Michael's not here to defend himself.
Mm-hmm. So you think the only reason they're doing it is because Michael is no
of course,
longer here?
Yeah.
And you don't buy that they wanted to protect him and that's why
Wade's never protected anyone in his life.
Does the whole family feel this way? I've seen the comments from the brothers, but I haven't heard anything from your sisters.
Everybody feels the same way about this.
Of course.
I think there's a fear as well to put more energy to it and more eyeballs to it. Mm. I think that's why my Aunt Janet hasn't said anything because she doesn't want to make it any bigger.
Why do you think they're coming forward now?
Money.
You think it's all about money?
Well, it's all about money.
It's always been about money. I hate to say it, when it's my uncle, it's almost like they see a blank check. And because they've been taken care of their whole life. And I think that's the problem. These people felt that they're owed something. You know, instead of working for something, they blame everything on my uncle.
Some would say there's a lot at stake financially for the Jackson family as well.
No. We don't get anything from this thing.
Emotionally, but not financially.
Though the Jacksons haven't seen the documentary and say they will never watch it, they take issue with filmmaker Dan Reed, who they say never reached out to the family for their side of the story.
So he took what they were saying face value as to be true. But he trusted them, but which is nothing wrong with that, but you must verify. Because when you start throwing allegations out about someone, then you got to go back and go, wait a minute, let me make sure I'm telling the right thing. Make sure they're not selling me a bunch of goods, which they were.
What do you want to say about your brother as this documentary is about to hit the country?
I want them to understand and know that this documentary is not telling the truth. There has not been not one piece of evidence that corroborates their story. And they're not interested in doing that.
Some would say, though, guys, it's hard for you to sit here and say the documentary isn't telling the truth when you haven't seen the documentary. Shouldn't you see the documentary,
Jackie? I don't care to say no, because I know my brother. I don't have to see the documentary. I know Michael. I'm the oldest brother. I know my brother. I know what he stood for, what he was all about, bringing the world together, making kids happy.
And he was never, in your opinion, abusive to children?
No, never.
Never,
never inappropriate with children?
Never, never
in a sexual way?
No, in a sexual way.
And the people that really know him, they know the truth, too.
Yeah, they are very adamant. As you see, they said that over and over and over again, and even asked different ways about Michael. They all go back to, we know him. The world doesn't know him the way we know him, and he would never, ever hurt a child, which is what Michael Jackson used to say all the time.
And look, I understand as a family, they want to defend and protect him. But one thing that stood out to me watching the documentary is how alone Michael Jackson seemed, mm-hmm. right? You didn't see the family around mm-hmm. him. In fact, he viewed these boys as family. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't necessarily work with what they're saying.
Yeah, he had a very complicated relationship with his family. And when you see the documentary, you will see he felt very close to strangers who you would think didn't know him as well as his family did. It's a very interesting dynamic all the way around, but they are very adamant about this. Michael Jackson did not do this. This is about money, and their brother is not here to defend himself. Michael Jackson's family is challenging allegations of sexual abuse against the late pop icon in a new HBO documentary. The movie that premieres this weekend shares the stories of Wade Robson and James Safechuck, who claimed Jackson abused them when they were young children. Jackson has faced similar allegations in the past. He settled a 1993 case and was acquitted in a 2005 criminal trial. Throughout it all, Michael Jackson denied any abuse, but continued to surround himself with young children, even inviting them into his bed. We asked his family about that behavior when they spoke to us first on CBS This Morning about the documentary.
I heard in the movie that there were actually things that were called love letters.
Michael Jackson's nephew, Taj, says he's a survivor of sexual abuse by a relative on his mother's side. He shared notes of encouragement that he got from his uncle when he was a child, similar to ones Safechuck and Robson say they received.
My uncle gave letters like that all the time to people that he cared about.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing salacious about it when you actually know there's a lot of people. He even did it to fans.
Taj Jackson says he spent much of his childhood at his uncle's Neverland ranch and took part in many of the famed slumber parties with children there.
It has been well documented. Your brother spoke many times about sharing his bed with young children. Mm-hmm. Did any of you at any time speak to him about that?
Well, when you phrase that, you know, sharing his bed, young kids having, they have sleepover camp out and just, you know,
his
everybody just lay
too.
In the bed and
his
fall asleep. His kids were there. Taj and were little at the time. And they all fall asleep in the bed and watching movies. And so you can twist it saying sharing his bed. But it makes you think something else.
Did it not seem odd to you, though, that your brother would share a bed or have slumber parties with young children?
He was there.
Yeah, I grew up in it. So for me, it wasn't odd.
It wasn't odd.
I think to the outside world, yes, I think it can be odd. I mean, I'm not oblivious to what it sounds like. But when you're actually there in that atmosphere and you're around it and you're watching movies.
With his kids, too.
Yes, with his kids. It's very innocent. But I think the fault of my uncle was he didn't have that bone in his body to look at it the other way. His naivety was his downfall. That's what hurts me more than anything, is knowing his innocence, but then knowing how the world is.
In early 1994, Jackson settled a civil suit with the family of Jordan Chandler, a boy who had accused a pop star of sexually abusing him. Despite paying over $22 million in that settlement, Jackson continued to surround himself with young children.
There are interviews with Michael where he has said, sure, people spent time in my bed. It was loving. It was a fun time. It was pure. And anyone who thinks anything other than that just has a dirty mind.
That's right.
That said, from the outside world looking in, it is very odd. You all don't think that it's odd that he would spend time?
No, let me say something. When we grew up coming up, traveling on the road, mm-hmm. we was older. But Marlon and Michael was much younger. They never had a regular childhood life. Michael always had been a kid at heart, always. He loved Disneyland, he loved those. So he tried to create that world himself. He loved that world. He loved making kids happy. His whole life was to make the whole world come together.
That's
peacefully.
What it's all about.
That's what it's all about, especially children. He loved that.
I mean, I think just knowing my uncle and spending thousands and thousands of hours with him, mm-hmm. he would always ask us questions like, what was this like? What was it like going to a birthday party, you know?
Because he didn't have that?
He didn't have that. He lived vicariously through me and my brothers and you know, his nephews.
None of you at any time said, you know, Michael, this doesn't look good. I know your intentions are pure, but this doesn't look good. None of you at any time said that to him?
I did.
You did?
I did. I asked him, I said, maybe you should just hang around family. And he said, well, then I'm not doing God's work. Then I'm not helping people. I'm not. Mm-hmm. My uncle always liked to help people. Mm-hmm. That was my uncle's purpose. That's what he felt he was doing. And he felt he connected with kids because that was his childhood.
As you sit here today, are you worried about what this documentary will do to his legacy?
No, not at all.
But it does seem to be a day of reckoning for many of our iconic figures.
And we don't want to get in the way of that. But you have to shine the light brightly on both sides.
Yeah, I think, you know, you'll have to watch the documentary and decide for yourself. I think the Jacksons clearly support their brother. And when people say it's all about money, they said they don't get any money from the Jackson estate. They wanted to make that very clear. The people that get the money are Michael Jackson's three children. And, you know, Wade and James, when we hear, you know, he didn't have a childhood, he was very childlike. I think when you hear the documentary, you may rethink, what does that really mean?
Yeah.
Raises a lot of very interesting questions.